morning. How are y'all? Can you hear me on the radio? All right. Hopefully Facebook's working. Everything is wet, so the camera may be a little bit fogged up. My glasses may fog up. I don't know what'll happen. Your windshield's fogged up, but we're going to keep on going. We're learning how to preach and do church in the elements, in the rain, and the fog, and whatever else is going on outside. My Bible's blowing everywhere. My notes are blowing everywhere. So I may run off and catch it if I have to. I may have to run off and catch it one time, but oh well. And if it starts raining, we're going to move out of the rain. But we're still going to have our church service. So welcome, everybody. I'm glad to see y'all here again. I'm hoping that that green thing on the radar will just hold off just for a little bit, right? That way we can not be interrupted and have distractions. Just a few announcements. Not doing a whole lot at the church. You haven't figured that out. But we are trying to do everything online. Wednesday night, 6:30. I'm doing the midweek service live at 6:30. You can watch it. I'm going to try to send out some notes tomorrow. And that way you can be a little bit prepared for Wednesday night. Maybe try to do it a little more or less sermony and more Bible study, if that's a word. But anyway, I'm going to try to send out an email and put it on Facebook on Monday, the material. That way you can have it and look at it before Wednesday. We're still, I'm hoping you're learning how to use technology. I kind of knew how to work Facebook before all this started. Now I'm getting better. So hopefully you've learned how to go to Facebook, get our app for the phone, go to our website. Hopefully you're learning all of this new technology, and hopefully you have internet at home and all that kind of stuff. But that's all we have, so that is the key way that we're communicating, so that I'm hoping that you've figured out how to work it. And of course, if you're listening to me right now, you probably have. But if you know somebody that hasn't or doesn't know what we're doing, give them a call. Let me know. I will call them and find out what's holding them back. Do they not know how to use Facebook on the phone? I didn't a couple of weeks ago. So what can we do to help them? I'm going to try to make a little how-to video and post it somewhere easy to get to and learn how to use it. If you go to our Facebook page, make sure you put the like button or the follow or the whatever the button that says I'm going to keep up with you. Otherwise, you got to search it and find it. And that way, when I do put something on there, it'll automatically pop up when you open it, hopefully. Share it. You can always, if you see something you like on the Crossroads Facebook, hit share. And that shows all of your friends. And that's kind of like inviting people to church. You know, when you share a post that says, this Sunday we're having drive-in church, and you share it, that's like inviting everybody in your list to church. It's kind of a new way to do it. It's a lot easier, isn't it? But you just hit share, and that gets the word out. It's crazy, but unbelievable. The statistics on Facebook are mind-boggling of how many people actually view the service and the video. You would be amazed, and God is good. And using Facebook, the devil's tool, God is good at using Facebook to get his word out. And that is really happening. I mean, thousands of people have been able to hear the word, even from Crossroads. It's unbelievable. So be sure you get in, tap in, share it, like it, all that stuff. Figure it out, because that's really all we got. And they're not telling me when we can go back to normal yet. So that's all we have. So be sure we get that figured out, or help someone else figure that out in your family or some friend. Call them up and say, make sure they're getting the information. So anyway, Facebook, the app, go to the website, click it, Facebook post, click it, enter your phone number, it goes to the phone. You have the sermons and the sermon notes, all of that kind of stuff. So we are just technology driven. And still continuing how to make it better and how to make it more personal and all of those kind of things. So that's what I do all week, is try to figure out a better way to make it better video, better sound. That's all we have, so I'm going to make the best use of it. So, glad you're here. Glad to see everybody. Hope the rain, y'all pray the rain will just go around us for a little bit. Let us have our service this morning. Will y'all pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We do thank you for allowing the technology to let us keep going and preaching and teaching your word. Lord, we pray that people are able to see and hear your word through the internet, through the Facebook, through the technology, through the FM transmitter, all the ways that belong to you, Lord, that we ask that you use them this morning, that your word will change hearts this morning. People's hearts that are hardened, that we ask that you soften their hearts this morning through your technology. That way they will turn to you and turn away from this world. We ask that you be with us and help stave off the distractions. That way we can focus on you. If we're sitting at home, help us quiet in our house to be able to hear your word. If we're sitting in our cars or sitting anywhere, wherever we are, help get rid of the distractions so we can hear your word, and your word can make a change in our lives. We thank you for what you're doing. We thank you that you're continuing to work no matter what the circumstances, and we thank you for you will continue to work. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So one other announcement before we get started. I'm using an FM transmitter that y'all are listening to in the parking lot. I'm also broadcasting on Facebook. Facebook is being monitored. If something happens, they'll come out and fix it. I want everybody to hear it. If y'all can't hear me in the car, yes, ma'am.
You're cutting out. You're like talking, but you're cutting out.
Okay. Like too loud?
No, just a pause. And
okay.
You're talking and then it cuts and then you miss a word.
Okay, we'll work on it. Thanks. So, what I was going to say is if you can't hear me and you're sitting in the parking lot and something happens and my voice doesn't work, let me know. Stop me. Otherwise, I'm talking to the air, right? It's kind of useless. I would rather you say, hey, like she just did, say, hey, Chris, it's not working. Great. We'll fix it. I keep my place and I'll get back in it. So we're going to work on, can you work on that?
Yeah.
On the sound clipping thing? I don't know what's happening. Could be the weather, yeah. So anyway, we're going to work on the sound deal in the meantime. So, are y'all ready?
Ready.
All right. Well, I put the words to the music on Facebook. If you're tech savvy, you can click on it and sing with them. Amen? Amen.
Thank you.
Got any headlights on?
One.
Thank you.
now let's choose up our dead prayer. Lord Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, Lord, that you've all been able to come down and to either watch or to watch through our guards. And Lord, thank you that even though we have this distance, you're still right here next to us. Lord, I pray for Brother Chris as he brings the word, Lord that minister to our hearts. Thank you for giving him the love for us. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Well, maybe we got the radio thing fixed a little bit. Maybe it won't cut out down a little bit. You may have to turn it up to hear my voice. Now, I don't know how it all works. But anyway, if you have your Bibles, we are in Mark chapter 4. You know, we were going through Mark. We made it all the way to chapter 4, and then we stopped and took a break, and we talked about witnessing and who's your one, and we did that for about 5 or 6 weeks, and then we had Easter, and here we are back in Mark. Just a quick recap, three chapters, Mark goes really fast, right? Mark is the condensed gospel. He gives you the main points. He doesn't get all crazy and talk a lot, right? He just tells it like it is and says this and this and this and this and this. That's kind of the way he writes. And this, he's just to the point. So we've covered a lot of information about Jesus' life and ministry in just three short chapters. He began by, Mark said, this is the beginning of the gospel. He talked about how it was foretold in the Old Testament that someone would come. And then we know John the Baptist came, or John the Baptizer came. He wasn't a Baptist, but he was a baptizer. John the Baptist came and prepared the way for Jesus. Jesus got baptized, and then he was led into the wilderness to get tempted by the devil for the three temptations. He starts preaching and teaching, and then he starts calling the disciples. He goes really fast. And each one of those things, we start to see how Jesus is operating and what he really came to do, and that he wasn't just a normal person, but he was God. He starts teaching and preaching, and he launches his ministry. He heals a man possessed by an evil spirit in church, in a synagogue. He heals somebody that's in church, in the synagogue, that's possessed. He's preaching and teaching from the book, and someone starts crying out. And my question was, how did that guy get in there, and how long had he been in church before he got delivered? Then he goes on to Peter's house that evening and heals Peter's mother-in-law. He starts, his ministry starts to have a huge effect, and he starts to get big crowds of followers and wanting what Jesus has, his healing ability. He heals a man with leprosy, the worst disease ever known, even back then, more than probably the coronavirus is having leprosy. Jesus heals the leper man. He also heals a paralyzed man that is lowered through the roof in a crowded area where Jesus is teaching and preaching. The man is lowered through the roof, and he heals him, and he tells him, I do this so you'll know that I have the power to forgive sins. That was the point of that story. And then he calls Matthew, he calls Levi, Matthew, the same thing, the tax collector. And then he has a party with them at their house. And then he's questioned, why does Jesus eat with sinners? Why does he hang out with the despised? You know, many of us use that as a crutch sometimes. Well, Jesus ate with sinners. Why can't I do these things? Well, and I answered that question, guess what? You're not Jesus, right? You don't have the power to be around all of that and not be tempted and not sin like Jesus. And he wasn't there just hanging out. He was there leading them and drawing them to God. So we always want to use that. Well, Jesus ate with sinners, but it doesn't really apply to us. He taught his disciples about fasting. He taught them about understanding the Sabbath and how we should take it and keep it holy. He heals a man with a messed up hand in the synagogue on the Sabbath, just to incite a riot almost. It says he looks around and he sees all the Pharisees watching him. waiting to see if he's going to heal this man on the Sabbath and break the law. And you know what? It says he looks around and he sees them, and he goes ahead and does it just to show them that a true heart and a true religion, not being a religionist, not being someone that claims to have a religion with no relationship to God, he says, I'm turning all of that upside down. And he heals the man with the messed up hand. Then he calls and he chooses the 12. At that point, he had many following him. But he calls and he brings aside the 12 that he chose, that we call the 12 disciples. And then towards the end of chapter 3, we see the religionists, the Pharisees, the scribes of the Jews, the church of the day, started really honing in and plotting against Jesus. And they started figuring out, how can they trap him? What are they going to do about him? They even call him demon-possessed at the very end. And Jesus quotes the famous scripture that says, no one who blasphemes the Holy Spirit will ever be forgiven. The unforgivable sin. See, many of us think the unforgivable sin could be something that we've done. Some past experience, something that's happened to us. Maybe have a divorce or something worse that we've been through or gone through, and we think Jesus can't forgive that, but that is wrong. That's not a fact. That's not the truth. This says right here, he said in chapter 3, verse 29, only blaspheming the Holy Spirit, only neglecting God and His love, only not accepting Him is the unforgivable sin. Because without acknowledging Him, without accepting Him, your sins cannot be forgiven. So it's kind of a funny thing. It's a thing that says, if you don't do this, your sins aren't forgiven. But if you do it, all sins are forgiven. There is no such thing as something that you can do so terrible that God won't forgive you, other than just rejecting His Son, Jesus Christ. And that's what He comes up. And then at the very end, we get the irony, the message that was hard for me to preach. It was about His family. His family had heard about how Jesus was acting, and they had come to take Him home. They had come to take Him captive because they thought He was crazy. And we think, no way would Mary and His brothers and all these people think that Jesus was crazy. Surely they believed. But if you read Scripture carefully, you'll see that at that point that they weren't all in. And they come to save Jesus from the Pharisees. They come to take Him home. They didn't want to see Him get hurt. Here He is acting crazy. The religionists are after Him. He's turning everything upside down. He's doing what they tell Him not to. And they're here to save Him. And we get the part where they show up, and Jesus is teaching in the house. And the people around Him say, hey, your mother and your brothers and your family, they're outside. They're here to get you. And He says, who are they? Who are my mothers? Who are my family? Who are my brothers but the ones that do the will of God? And He was talking about the very ones sitting around. He says, you are my family now. You are the ones that are doing the will of God. You are my family. And that's where we ended chapter 3. And so here we are starting chapter 4. In the next couple of chapters, we're going to hear a lot of teaching from Jesus. Not just events, but words from Him. Teaching. We're going to hear about parables. And we're also going to see His authority. He has authority over the weather. He calms a storm. He raises a little girl back to life. And on the way to do that, He heals another lady that's been sick for 12 years. We're going to see that He is in control. We're going to hear parables about the sower, which we're going to talk about today. We're going to hear a parable about who lights a light and puts it under a basket. You know, the kids' song. We're going to hear about that. We're going to hear about the mustard seed, the seeds that grow, all of these things. And we're even going to learn why Jesus used parables. So there's lots of great information coming. And here we are in chapter 4, beginning in verse 1. And we're going to go through verse 20. And my Bible is blowing all over the place, so we're going to have to just bear with me here. So this morning, we're going to have the parable of the sower. Now, you may have heard this story before. You may have think that you know all of the parts to it, but there is a lot to it. This is one of the key teachings. This is the first parable, I believe, that Jesus taught in Mark, and he's trying to get these key points. Mark is trying to get us to know what it takes to hear the Word of God this morning. A sower went out to sow seeds. And that's what a tongue twister, a sower sowing seeds. Seems like we could have come up with something better. But anyway, I couldn't. But a sower sowing seeds, and some fell by the wayside. Some fell on stony ground. Some fell among the thorns. And finally, some fell in good soil. This parable, this lesson, is actually kind of two parts. I'm only going to focus on one, but the first part is really to the sower, to the messenger, to the disciple, to continue on sowing seeds and talking and telling people about the Word of God. And it's talking to us, telling us, no matter what the difficulty, no matter how hard-headed someone may be, continue on. Hang on, now I know what I'm cutting out. Continue on to sow those seeds. We've got a pit stop. So we want to continue on sowing those seeds, no matter the difficulty, no matter the opposition. When Jesus stood before people and preached, when Jesus stood before people and preached, he knew that not all people would get it. He knew that some people had closed minds, closed hearts, hard hearts. He knew some that were shallow and just wanted to find out what he had to offer. Maybe they were sick. Maybe they just showed up to get a healing and then go on their way. Jesus, I need a little bit of something to make my life better. He knew they were in the crowd. He knew they were there. He knew there were the well-to-do in the crowd, you know, the worldly-minded, the ones that don't worry about anything because they've got it all made, the ones that are entangled in all of their stuff. He knew they were all there, but he kept preaching. He kept sowing. And so this is a lesson to the sowers, the disciples, the ones that are witnessing to the hard-headed people, the ones that you think you're not doing any good by inviting them to church, and they say, no way, Jose. Or you start telling them, or you post something on Facebook and they reject you. Or you send them a letter and they don't respond. Or you have a family member that you're trying to reach. And for whatever reason, you just can't get through. Jesus and you are no exception. Jesus had the same problems. But he continued on. And so this first lesson is an encouragement to us as a sower to not give up. The second is the lesson of receiving the word, and how different hearts, different minds receive the Word of God. How we take it in. See, we all have different ranges. Some of us are hard, like the concrete. Some of us are like the soil in the flower bed, ready to take the seed. The condition of your heart determines how you will love God, and it determines how you will love your neighbor. It's the condition of your heart. That's why this parable is so important. Jesus paints the picture of the various soils, of the various hearts, of the various people that he's preaching to, that he's teaching, and the various hearts that we have today. Possibly in this parking lot today, possibly hearing me right now live, possibly hearing me in the future as this is recorded. So here we are. Let's read Mark chapter 4, verses 1 through 20. Bear with me, it's 20 verses, but it's well worth it. Mark chapter 4, verse 1. And again he began to teach by the sea, and a great multitude was gathered to him, so that he got into a boat and sat in it, in the sea, and the whole multitude was on the land facing the sea. He then taught them many things by parables, and he said to them in his teaching, "Listen, behold, a sower went out to sow, and it happened as he sowed that some seed fell by the wayside, and the birds of the air came and devoured it. Some fell on stony ground, where it didn't have much earth, and immediately it sprang up because it had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, it was scorched because it had no roots, and it withered away. And some seed fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no crop. But the other seed fell on good ground and yielded a crop that sprang up, increased, and produced some 30-fold, some 60, and some 100-fold. And he said to them, "He who has ears to hear," everybody got ears this morning? "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." But when he was alone, those around him with the 12 asked him about the parable. What's going on? And he said to them, "To you it has been given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to those who are outside, all things come in parables, seeing that they may see and not perceive, hearing they may hear and not understand, lest they should turn and their sins be forgiven them." And he said to them, "Do you not understand this parable? How then will you understand all the parables? The sower sows the word. And there are the ones by the wayside where the word is sown, where they hear. When they hear, Satan comes immediately and takes away the word that was sown in their hearts. These likewise are the ones on stump. These likewise are the ones sown on stony ground. When they hear the word, immediately receive it with gladness, and they have no root in themselves, so endure only for a time. Afterward, when tribulation or persecution comes for the word's sake, immediately they stumble. Now these are the ones among the thorns. They are the ones who hear the word, and the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, and the desire for other things enter in, choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful. But these are the ones sown on good ground. Those who hear the word, accept it, and bear fruit, some 30, some 60, and some 100-fold. Will y'all pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this word. Lord, I pray that it sinks into our hearts. You find good soil this morning, that we see exactly who we are and where we stand with you and what we need to do about it. Lord, I pray if there's any hard ground here today that you will begin to till, that you will knock it down, that you will till it up, that you will ground it up, that you will soften it up. I pray on each one, each type of heart, that you will prepare them more and more to hear your word this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So Jesus began a new method of teaching. He began to teach by parables. And note, he was by the sea again. He teaches a lot by the sea. And if you remember back in chapter 3, this should kind of look familiar. He was teaching by the sea, and he actually told his disciples to get a boat ready in case he had to escape, because they were coming in so much. They were pressing in on him so much. He had to get his bug out vehicle ready. He says, "Y'all get my boat ready just in case I got to jump in and get out." But this time, it says he went ahead and got in the boat. I think that's funny. I think he knew it was coming. He says, "I'm not going to mess with it. I'm not going to worry about the boat. I'm just going to go ahead and get in the boat and preach from the boat because they're coming." I just thought that was funny. This crowd is rushing in, and Jesus just goes ahead. He's learning from his past. Kind of like I'm learning from last week, I need paper clips on my papers, right? So he starts teaching about this parable from a boat, from the sea. Now, a parable literally means, what is a parable? It literally means a comparison side by side. What he is doing, parable means he is comparing an earthly truth and a heavenly truth. And he's trying to show us this thing on earth is the same thing as this thing in heaven. And that's exactly what the parable means. It literally means it's placing something side by side. He's trying to show you something on earth that we know, that we can recognize, and something that's in the kingdom of heaven, or the kingdom of God, or how Jesus acts. And he's trying to show them. And this earthly story, if we dig into it a little bit more, if we start digging into the details, we can learn more about the kingdom of heaven. And we think about it, we meditate it, we see more of the truth. That's why he teaches us this. And Jesus is the master user of, or teller of, parables. I can't make up my own parables. I have to usually copy somebody, or I'll use a Jesus parable and reword it or something. I'm not real good at making up parables, but Jesus was the master. I think he invented the thing, probably. I don't know. But this story, starting in verse 3, is just a simple story. But yet its meaning is profound. The farmer sows some seeds. How simple. We planted a garden this year, but I went down to the store and bought some little plants. I didn't want to mess with the seeds, because I didn't know if it was grass or the plant that would come up, and I probably picked the wrong thing. But I bought some plants. But anybody that's ever had a garden or sowed seeds will identify. Back then, they knew what it was about. The farmer's throwing some seeds, sowing some seeds. And there are two kinds that do not take root at all. Two kinds of seeds don't even have a chance. And the one is the ones that fall on the wayside. You know, the area around the field that you've been turning your tractor around on, or that you've been walking on, you've been stepping on, the compacted ground, in the corner where you can't get. Some of that seed falls there on the ground that can't seep in. It's in the corners, the hard to reach places. And then there's some of the seeds that fall on the stony ground, where the rocks are. You know, the rocks are just under the surface, and you think you've got something. Have you ever been building a fence? We were building a fence the other day, and you start digging a fence hole, and you're like, oh, this is easy. And then you hit the rock right below it, right, or the clay. See, that rock holds heat. It holds everything ready to go. So when that seed hits it, it bursts up. But it has no root. When something comes, the sun kills it and scorches it. Then there are two kinds that do take root. The one kind that actually goes into the thorny areas. You know, when you till your ground, if you don't kill the weeds first, when you till it up, all you did was spread those weeds even more. And they come up in more places. And they come up quicker than your crop. So some of that seed goes into the thorny ground, and the thorns come up, and they outpace the crop, and they choke it out. And then finally, there's the seed on the good soil that's ready to go, that's prepared, that wants it. And it grows up, and it produces much fruit. But in verse 8, we see that even all of that, even the little bit of seed that makes it in the good soil, even that doesn't even produce all of the way. We see that some only 30% produce. That means 70% unfruitful. Then we see, he says, 60% produce. That means 40 is unproduced. And then he goes all the way down, and there's only a little bit left that says produces 100%. The farmer sows everywhere to see that a little bit takes, a little bit works, and that's Jesus' heart. That's my heart. I will talk until y'all all leave, because you're tired of hearing me talk. But I'm hoping that something sticks, a little bit, that will produce fruit. That's Jesus' heart. That's every preacher's heart. That the Word of God will sink in and produce fruit. Jesus ends in verse 9. He says, if you have ears, hear. Listen. If you have ears, hear. Luke tells us that in Luke's version of this parable, it says Jesus cried this out, yelled it. If you have ears, listen. It's as important as what he's saying. He cries it out. And then in verse 10, later on after telling the parable, it says a lot of people left, and only a few stayed back. They had the 12 disciples, and then it says those that are with them or with him. So we don't know how big of a crowd, but we can get the picture. There was a smaller crowd that hung back with the 12, and it says they ask him about the parables. They ask him, what's going on? Now, we don't know exactly what they ask. My thoughts are they ask two questions. Number one, they said, Jesus, why do you talk this way, man? Why do you speak in parables that I can't understand? I've asked him that too. Why do you talk like this? Why are you telling me stories that I can't get all these pictures? And then the other question they say is, what is the meaning of, or they ask, what is the meaning of this parable? What does it mean to me? He answers in Mark 4:11, he says, to you it's been given to know the mystery in the kingdom of God, but to those who are on the outside, all things come in parables. What? Now, I don't even understand the answer to your question. What are you talking about? At first, it seems like some people are getting special treatment. To you, I've given the answer, but to them, I don't give them the answer. And that's what it looked like to me. To you, you're special, you're smart, you're my little select. I'm going to give you the mysteries, but to those, I'm not giving the mysteries. But that's not what he says. If you dig in a little bit more, that's not what's going on. Jesus wants all to be saved. Don't miss that ever. Don't ever forget that Jesus came not to condemn the world, but for the world to be saved. He wants everybody to return to him. You see, there was a crowd. He did tell the parable, and some of that crowd went away. Most of that crowd went away on their own. He told the parable to the whole crowd, yet most of them went away, and only a few stayed back. Only a few stayed back to say, "What is? Give me some more. I didn't really catch all of that. What about this seed? Maybe I need to write it down again. I have a question. What's going on?" Only a few stayed back that were hungry. See, you only have two responses to a parable. The disciple, the follower of Jesus, the interested ones, they stay back. They want to know more. They don't just hear the words. They hear the message. They hear it with their hearts. They're receptive. They're willing to change their life. They want to know more, Jesus. Tell me more. What did I miss? And I'm willing to obey. I want to know this answer so I can change my life. And God reveals the mysteries of the kingdom to them. He'll tell you whatever you want to know. He'll tell you what you ask. He'll give you what you seek. On the other hand, the unbelievers left. They hear the parable, but it's just a good old story. Have you ever heard preachers that just tell good old stories and you leave after church and you're like, man, that was a good sermon. That was a good story. And I say, what does it mean? I don't know. It's just a good story. I don't tell good stories. I'm going to tell you what the Bible says. But this crowd, many of them left thinking, well, that's just a good story. I don't know what he meant, but yeah, I know about farmers. I know they grow seed. I know some don't go there. I know some go in good soil. So what? You ever heard those people? I've heard that Bible verse before. I got that. I know that. I know we're supposed to love our neighbors. I know we're supposed to love God. I know how I'm supposed to treat my wife. Well, do it. There's a difference. That's the ones that walk away. That's the ones with the hard hearts. That's the ones that know everything, right? I know all about sowing seed. See the difference? You see the different response? It says, them that are outside, they just hear the words. They're not listening with their heart. They hear a good story. And then he quotes Isaiah chapter 6, verse 9 and 10. Jesus quotes it. Seeing that they may not perceive, hearing they may not understand. And then here's the word that really gets to me. He says, lest they should turn. Sounds like he doesn't want them to. But that's the complete opposite. What he's talking about is they're unwilling to receive. They know that if they turn to Christ, They know, I know, if I believe in Jesus and I put my trust and faith in Jesus Christ, I might have to change my life. I might have to do something that I don't want to do. So I'm just going to hold that back. I'm going to stall my decision just a little bit longer because I really like doing what I got going on. I got to finish this. Jesus isn't stopping them from coming to Him. We stop ourselves. Because if I learn a little bit more, if I learn that I have to forgive others, if I really accept the fact that if I don't forgive others, Jesus won't forgive me, oh my gosh, I might have to forgive somebody else and I might have to turn back to God. So I don't want to listen. Lest I should turn. Lest I should be forgiven of my sins. You see, that's what Jesus' heart is saying. It's our choice. It depends on whether we come to Him. There's the law of spiritual conditioning. The more you harden your heart to God, the less you're going to receive. It's a spiral. The opposite is also true. The more you read the Word, the more you put your joy and faith in Christ, the more spiritual joy you will receive. It's an up spiral. You're not exempt. You either harden your heart or you open your heart. Those that are on the outside are rejecting Christ. Those on the outside are hard-hearted or too shallow or too caring about the world. They don't want to perceive the message. They don't want to stop doing the things they like to do. And then in the second part, I think Jesus answers the second question. You know, the first question is, why do you teach in parables? And He says, so you'll make you want to know more. Or you'll just go about saying it's a good story. And then He answers, somebody must have asked, what about this parable? What does it mean? Because He goes into it. What verse are we at? Verse 13. Someone must have said, what about this parable? And Jesus sighed and He rolled His eyes. No, that's not what it says. But it says He did say to them. But I can just see this. Can you picture it? You just got through quoting. If you don't understand, something's wrong with you, right? You got a hard heart. And I can just see it in the group as a classroom teacher. I saw this. Someone raises their hand after Jesus just said, if you don't get it, right? What does this parable mean? Oh my gosh. Even if Jesus is frustrated, we don't know that He is. I would be probably, yeah? I'm human. But what does He do? He goes right into the answer. He starts to explain it. He doesn't say He sighed and rolled His eyes. He just says He taught it. He wanted you to know. He says, if you don't get this, how are you going to get the rest? Here we are. Let's get to it. The seed by the wayside is unplowed. It doesn't take the seed. The person doesn't hear the Word of God. Actually, they hear the Word of God, but they don't take it in. You get that? The seed gets on them. They hear the Word of God. They are in church. They listen to the radio. They watch Facebook. The seed gets them. But it doesn't go anywhere. They're hard-hearted. They're off to the side. They're out of the way. They're uninvolved. They may go to church, but they don't really care. They let their mind wander. They're thinking about everything else. Of course, they respect the church. They like the preacher. They know their kids need to be in church. But they're not letting it in their own heart. They're on the outer circle, paying very little attention to the warnings of Jesus Christ. They are not a disciple of Jesus. Hard hearts like pavement. Before the person believes, the devil comes and snatches it away, hardly even giving them a chance. Then the seed on the rock, or the stony ground, like the driveway, or even this flower bed is full of rocks. The stony ground. Some of the seed is hitting that too. They hear it. They become excited over it. They may even confess a belief in Jesus. Yeah, I want some of that Jesus. But it doesn't take root. It doesn't get down into their hearts. They fail to count the cost. They fail to count the cost of effort, of studying, of learning, of getting involved. They let the crowd with the other people, they still let, hey, I got things to do. I ain't got time to sit around with you guys around a campfire with a guitar and talk about Jesus. I got to get out of here. I got things to do. But then I profess Jesus, but when something happens, when the corona comes, when the fires of tribulation and trials come, the sun burns them out. They're gone. Not a disciple of Jesus Christ. Then there's the ones that hear. It's getting among the thorns. They hear. They profess to live as Christ. I'm a professing believer of Jesus. I join in. I'm in the deal. I walk and I'm doing the right things. Except the world, the thorns that's surrounding us. The worldly thorns, they're going to choke you out. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17, he talks about coming out from among them. Get out of the thorns. Get out of the worldliness. See, we don't want to completely cut off from the world. We still like that illusion of stability. We're scared to go to the rock of stability of Jesus Christ. We still think the world has something for us. We live a double life, trying to live for Christ, yet still seeking out all the things in the world, living for the worldly. We keep going right in the midst of all of that. Not a disciple of Christ. It even says that fruit appears, but it doesn't even become good to eat. It says it becomes unfruitful over time. The thorns get it. And finally, the good ground. This is the honest, the good, the faithful, the trusting heart. The fruitful life. The honest and the good heart. The one that wants the word. Tell me more, Jesus. I'm messed up. I get it. But I need to know more. That's when he looks at you with compassion and he gives you the answer. He doesn't roll his eyes inside. And he gives you the answer. And when you get the answer, you keep it. And you do it. No matter how funny the world may seem, Noah built an ark and it wasn't raining. And they all laughed at him. The good soil does what Jesus says, even if all laugh at him. See, there's three steps involved in bearing fruit. And that's hear the word. Receive the word of God. Receive his preaching. And then bringing forth the word, that is living for God, producing fruit. The definition of a disciple is we follow Jesus. Why do we follow Jesus? To be more like him. Why do we want to be more like him? To do his work. To continue on his work. 2 weeks ago, we did John 15:5. I am the vine, you are the branches, you abide in me, you will produce much fruit. But without me, you can do nothing. That's why we become a disciple of Christ. In the beginning of the sermon, I said there were two lessons here. There are two great lessons in this parable. Number one is to those that are actually sowing. To the ones, the witnesses, the evangelists, the ones that are telling their family members, the ones that are on the front lines, in the trenches, and it feels like no matter what you do, you just hit a brick wall. The ones trying to get their friend through the roof to Jesus, there are going to be obstacles. And I want to encourage you this morning to never give up. Some of that seed will take. The Bible says that God's word will not return void. It will not return without effect in some way. Don't give up. But then the other side, the great lesson of this parable is receiving that seed. How do we receive that seed? Our hearts. The soil is like our hearts. It's either hard, like pavement, or it's soft and faithful and ready to receive the word of God. So my question to you this morning, what kind of heart do you have? You knew that question was coming, right? What kind of heart do you have? What kind of soil are you made out of? Are you just flat, hard, not even listening, thinking it's just another story? You might go away not perceiving, but I don't think so. I've been very clear this morning. I've tried to be very clear this morning on what this parable means. Jesus said the parable and they left. I've tried to break it down. We are without excuse what this parable means. Have you perceived it? Or are you just refusing to perceive it, lest you should turn back to God? Are there things in your life that you have that are more important, that you want to hold on to, that you want to let go and return to God? Are you doing it to yourself? Jesus is calling each one of us. And I urge you this morning. I implore you this morning. I plead with you this morning. Turn away from the world and return to God. That's what Jesus came to do. That's what he came to say. Are you going to leave with the rest of the crowd looking for the next great story? Or are you going to stay back? Not today, because I'm going home after lunch. But are you going to stay back? Are you going to meditate? Are you going to listen? Are you going to ask him to show me more in your life? The choice is yours. You must turn away from the world. The one thing that's going to dissolve away. The one thing that has no happy ending is the world. And turn to God, the one thing that will never fall away for all of eternity. The condition of your heart this morning determines, will you respond or be closed-minded? The thing is, God holds you responsible this morning. God does hold us responsible. God holds you responsible today, and he will hold you responsible for what you do with his word and the condition of your heart. He holds you responsible to the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. He's going to ask you one day, what did you do with my son? What did you do with Jesus that I sent to you? Did you ignore him and walk away and say, thanks for the story, old man? Or did you take him in and trust him and place your faith in Jesus Christ? What are you going to do this morning? I urge you to accept him. Will you respond or will you leave? If you've never placed your faith in Christ, right now is the time to do it. Tell him. Don't tell me. Tell Jesus. We're going to pray in a minute. In about 10 seconds, we're going to pray. You just tell him, Lord, I want to come back to you. I want to come to you. Maybe I've never even done it before. Lord, I want you. I want to come to you. I don't want to be a rock-hard place. I don't want to be a hard head. I don't want to be cast in the fire. I want to be part of your life. I don't want to have it more abundant. I want to trust you with my life today and for eternity. Tell him. You tell him. Will y'all pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much again for this morning. Thank you for teaching us this parable, this story. Thank you for showing us. Thank you for showing us that you don't give up sowing seeds no matter where they land. Lord, give us the strength and the encouragement to continue sowing seeds wherever we go, wherever they land. Lord, I also pray that if anyone is here and their heart is not ready for the soil, that you will start and plow them up right now, that they will be able to take it in and it will take root and produce fruit, not 30, not 60%, but 100%. Lord, if there is anyone here in the sound of my voice, I pray that they turn to you right now. No matter what, there's no unforgivable sin. No matter what they have done or done to them, no matter what they think, stand on your word that you say you will forgive us. I pray that they turn to you right now and tell you from their heart and repent and return to you and place their faith and trust in you this morning. Wherever they are in this world, in this hour, they will do it. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for bringing us here this morning. We thank you for this technology again. Lord, I do pray that you be with those that are battling the illness, whether they have the illness, whether they have the virus, or they are out battling the virus on the front lines. We ask you to be with the businesses as they make the best use and the best decisions. We ask that you be with the leaders of government and schools as they make the best decisions in this circumstance, that there is no precedent. There's nowhere else to look but you. There's no book, there's no history to look at but you, Lord. We pray that they turn to you to seek answers and make the best godly decision. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for everything. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Thank y'all very much for coming. It is very good to see y'all. Whatever y'all get out of seeing each other, I get it also. Sometimes, I said on Wednesday night, it gets a little lonely preaching to empty chairs. And I thank y'all for coming. Y'all support me as I preach. And I pray that I support y'all also. Thank y'all for coming. Y'all be careful. I'm not having class after church, but I wish we could all stay back and talk about Jesus until supper time. But I do pray that y'all heard more than a story this morning. Amen. Don't forget, Wednesday, 6:30, same bat time, same bat channel. We'll be back on Facebook Live. Look out for your email. Look out for Facebook on the lesson for next Wednesday. Y'all have a good week. Amen. Bye-bye.